Ancient man looks at the boundless sky beyond the clouds. Forever serene, shielding, and meditative. And man wants to believe that it is an auspicious and sacred force, Achhadan. The sky protects the Leelamayi earth. The sky and the earth gaze at each other from a distance. Rain pours from the skies, and the earth nurtures life. Man is passive, woman is life-giving. They come together to sustain life. Male and female, the two forces are worshipped together, and slowly over time are given human forms and godly attributes. Shiv, Mahadev, is the supreme being. Shakti, Mahadevi, surrounds him in Maya. With each production, she takes a different form. And Shiv gets more and more enchanted. Thus, the universe is created.
Tana dere na, tana dere tom tere.
comes buddhi. Then ahankar. Then mana. Pancha Gyanendriya.
Pani mava gama sagaligasa.
Didididana. Sani bama gama gasani sagagasa.
Pancha Karmendriya.
Tana derena.
Pancha Tanmatra.
Tana. Gababani.
Pancha Bhuta. Samalaya. The universe is in harmony and moves in perfect chanda. But then, for reasons beyond control, there is disruption. Vaishamya Chandapatan. Mahadevi Mahamaya withdraws herself from the Maya of her own making. And Pralaya threatens to destroy the world. Narayan, Sthiti, awakens to soothe Shiv with his Narayani Shakti. Now, Narayani shelters Shiv. Ashray.
Vagartha viva.
Vag artha
संप्रिक्तौ
वागर्थाविव संप्रिक्तौ
वागर्थ प्रतिपत्तये
जगत पितरा वंदे
पितरो वंदे
पार्वती
मखा गणपत मनसा स्मरामि मखा देव मुदौ शिरसा नमामि मखा गणपत मनसा स्मरामि ओ
We can deal with this topic from different angles. One thing perhaps we can see the basic difference between the concept of success, siddhihi, that our Rishis have and the contemporary concept. According to the economists, starting from Adam Smith, human being is a consumer, a desirer. It comes from a concept, a theological concept perhaps, that everyone is inadequate, imperfect, and naturally each one is a desirer. Being a desirer, the desire is always to be different. Even one desires to have position, power, money, name. In all this, there is a desire to become different from what I am now. So the whole life is a process of becoming Because one desires to become more powerful, more rich, more famous, more popular, more accomplished. This is a universal thing about a human being, and therefore our rishis did not miss to recognize this. They recognize the same thing. In fact, in the Bhagavad Gita, this is a statement, here is a statement, that ragadveshav sarvesham buddhav vyavasthitav. Your desires can be categorically said to be of two types. One, a desire to accomplish, to have, to possess, to experience positive. Desire positive. There is equally a powerful desire to avoid and also to get rid of. So desire to acquire consumes your time and energy, your attention, your skills, your manipulative powers, and desire to avoid also consumes a lot of time. When there is more uncertainty than usual in the economical status of a country, the political, social, then one has to spend more time to avoid than to acquire. Correct? Very unfortunate. All the time you have to think how to avoid this pitfall, how to avoid this, because the hidden variables become more and more. Never there was a human being on this earth who didn't have to face the hidden variables. Every human being with a limited knowledge and power has to face the hidden variables. But not the modern hidden variables. Somebody sneezes somewhere in America, our rupee makes a nosedive. That is a hidden variable. And like this, you have a number of hidden variables. Therefore, we spend a lot of time planning and doing to avoid certain pitfalls. And there are things that we don't want to have in life. Nobody wants to be bald, even though one finds it difficult to avoid. Nobody wants his hair turning gray. Nobody wants a number of things. Nobody wants a headache, nobody wants an ulcer, nobody wants a heart attack. A lot of things one wants to avoid. And in order to avoid, you pay attention. Your daily exercise, your constitutional walk, and your calorie management, all this are meant only to avoid. Takes a lot of your time. And in spite of your efforts, of course, the truth is, they sneak in. And naturally, you have to get rid of them. The headache, nobody welcome headache, invited headache. But uninvited, one picks up headache and one has to avoid. Now one has to get rid of it. Therefore, our time is shared by these two types of desire. Desire to accomplish and to retain, of course, and desire to avoid and to get rid of. So our rishis here in the Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna or Vyasa, calls them as, Krishna calls them as raga and dvesha. Not an ordinary thing, I tell you. This has a far-reaching consequence, this raga dvesha. So the raga and dvesha, both of them are desires. The common word for raga dvesha is kama. Kama is a common word. So this kama desire, everybody has, whether one is illiterate or highly educated, one is religious or irreligious, everyone has. And this desire is also in our thinking, is looked upon as a privilege. In the Gita, Krishna is presented as the Lord. Whether historical or otherwise, it is the Lord speaking. And he says, I am in the form of desire in a human head. Bahut bada. This is a very big thing it is. Kamosmi Bharata Rishabha. Aham kamaha asmi. The Lord says that I am there as a desire in a human mind. He has one more word to say. We will look at that later. So I am a desire in a human mind means it's a privilege. So desiring is a privilege. Desiring is not something that freely available, as freely as it is available for a human being in a cow. The cow cannot desire to have a camera. It doesn't have it, it cannot have it. That's the thing. Doesn't have it is okay, because a lot of human beings also don't have it. But human beings can have it, but the cow cannot have it. It will never steal a camera lying somewhere. Nor it will go on a buying spree. It doesn't go. It cannot. That Ichha Shakti, it has its own desire. Program, as you all know. So it is programmed, totally programmed, naturally programmed. Whereas you have a freedom in desiring. And therefore, you can feel good that the Lord says, I manifest in you in the form of this desire. That's a privilege. Some people think if you have desire that you are away from God. The Lord says, I am very desire itself, how can you be away? That's very reassuring. So you can have a few more desires, please. So that Lord will keep being with you, okay? Will remain with you. But he has got some conditions that you will see later. There is a class around. And therefore, that you have a desire, that you have this power to desire, is a privilege endowed upon you. Okay? If there is a privilege, any privilege is enjoyable. Correct? What is a privilege which is miserable? You will be without it. A privilege is something that is enjoyable, that you can use it when you want it. That's a privilege. One of our cricketers was given the membership of, MCC. And he went to Gavaskar, not ordinary. It's a privilege. He was given this membership. He enters into this building at the lodge for attending a cricket match, a test match. He was stopped at the gate because he didn't have membership card or whatever. So that privilege is, he has to accept his privilege. He can go, he need not go, that is a privilege. So that you have desires is a privilege. And therefore they should be a source of enjoyment for you, that make you dynamic, that make you explore and do, and face consequences, kind of adventure. Why anybody should climb the mountains if there is no kick in that? Unless you have this great privilege to work for, to fulfill. The problem is, this is our philosophy here. Up to this, of course, we have added little more, that the privilege, the desiring is a capacity given to us, and in desire is the manifestation of Ishvara, the Lord. That's an addition. Otherwise, it's all the same. It's universal. So the modern economists, as well as the pioneer of economics as a subject, the pioneer of this subject, Adam Smith. So well, he is right and others are right, that man has desires. Then these desires have to be fulfilled. True. Desires do not embellish a person if they don't need to be fulfilled. Desire itself is the motive force to make you do things. And therefore it sets you in action. It powers you to do. Therefore that desire activates you, find, makes you do. The problem here is, in the West, these desires have to be fulfilled. Then only you can be happy. Not in the West, it is everywhere, I suppose. People think like that. That's where perhaps we have something to talk, something to share. Desires have got to be fulfilled. Otherwise, they are not desires really. That means one has to plan, one has to take into account the hidden variables, and one has to execute the plan, one has to find the resources, the manpower. All that is implied in the process of fulfilling any given desire. Suppose it is not fulfilled, it's okay. Can you say that? It's okay? No, it's not okay. That means, if it is not okay, it's no more a privilege. Understand? If it is not okay, it's not a privilege. It ceases to be a privilege. It is only a privilege in the drishti, in the vision of Krishna or Vyasa. But in reality, an unfulfilled desire leaves me disappointed with a sense of failure. But it is not one, please understand. It is always there all through my lifetime. Even as a child, as far as I could remember, I always had desires which I could not fulfill. Who didn't want to score 100%? Who didn't fantasize hitting sixes and fours in a cricket match? Who didn't imagine coming first in each sports event? Well, we all had chased, we all had settled always for something less and less and less and less. In other words, our pie has always been humble, never rich. All the time we have been meeting with some success, siddhi. The word siddhi, make a note. Siddhi means success. We always, siddhi means we think that some vibhuti. Siddhi means success. If you take the fulfilled desires and the unfulfilled desires into account both, you find the unfulfilled are more than fulfilled. It was always like this. The third year, fourth year, fifth year, sixth year, seventh year, 25th year, it is the same. Married, the unfulfilled desires are more. They multiply. Every day you want to fulfill something, you want to change the other person. The other person wants to change you. These are the desires which you can never fulfill. Especially when you want to change the other person. 25 years of marriage, both the persons have been trying sincerely day after day to change the other. Remain the same. And then each one tells me, Swamiji, she comes to her talks, please do something to her. And then she comes and tells, I am told he comes to you, so please do something. Both of them come to me, both of them want the other to change. It's very clear that these desires remain just as frustration in the individual. This is centered on you. Understand? You are, that's why in the beginning itself I said, you are the desirer. It's not just a desire. You are the desirer. So the desire unfulfilled, the desirer is affected, me affected. And not one, two, three, it is many, and some of them are very crucial. Lot of desires, especially youngsters in India, they want to go out somewhere, at least Saudi Arabia, doesn't matter. I don't know why anybody should go to Saudi Arabia. It is one country where you can't open your mouth. I was told they get the tonsillectomy done through the ears. That's what I was told. Tonsillectomy, you know, removing of the tonsil, and they can't, the surgeon cannot open the mouth of an Indian. And therefore he goes through the ears, you know. Why anybody should go? With some punya you were born in this country. This is a punya bhumi. Why anybody should go to any other country, especially this Saudi Arabia? That's why I always like Ramkos. At least it's able to retain some Indians here. Some educated, the software guys here. All the software goes away and only hardware is left behind. What? And unfulfilled desires are too many, affecting the person. Therefore, look at this now. Siddhi, success, how our Shastra looks at. So from the modern standpoints, naturally, we are all failures. Every human being is a failure. Everyone. Whether he becomes the president of this country or the prime minister of the country, everybody is a failure. A sense of failure is always centered on every individual. No matter how big he is, it's all relative. So a number of things, in fact, when you become little bigger, you have got bigger plans. You want something to do. Suppose you want to change the society, you want to change the ways of life of people, the lifestyles of people. You want to change the very structure, infrastructure of a country. You want to do. You can't do it. So a failure. Even inspired people have their own failures. So whether the person is working for a public cause or for personal cause or because of something else, whatever, that everybody has to face this nightmare of this helplessness and failure. It is centered on oneself. It is not a visiting nightmare on some bad nights. It is centered on oneself. You have to sleep to this person in order to laugh. You have to drown this person in order to relax. And while relaxing, this person will pop up. And therefore, the concept of success either is drastically wrong or the concept itself is a redundant concept, is a irrelevant concept because there is no such thing as success. Individual success may be there in an individual undertaking up to a point. But as a whole, life as a whole, if you look at it, then definitely the unfulfilled desires are more, outnumber the fulfilled ones. What does the Gita say? What is our philosophy of success? In other words, it says, hey, desires are a privilege. You are free to desire. Why don't you retain that freedom even in the process of fulfilling it? And even while facing the result, why don't you retain that freedom? Why do you surrender the freedom to the very privilege? Privilege somehow turns into some kind of a necessity. It's like luxury. Someone said, luxury is a visiting guest. Comes to your house. She is a nice woman. She is a guest. Means you can be without her. She is only a visiting guest. But somehow she manages to remain there forever. A time comes when you cannot be without her. That is what luxury is. In your own life, you can narrate a few. In a village, to wear a pair of shoes and go to the school was a luxury. When it was luxury, shoes were a luxury. When the road was slushy, the boy would pick up the shoes from his feet and carry them on his head so that they are saved and he would walk all right. Luxury. Afterward, shoes became a necessity. Nobody thinks I have shoes. A bicycle was a luxury and nobody thinks I have a bicycle. It's a necessity. A scooter was a luxury in the beginning and you were cleaning it, wiping it, keeping it clean. Not even your body you keep as clean as your scooter. Because luxury, you have a shirt for it also. And everything you have, and after some time is nothing. It's a necessity. For the one who doesn't have a scooter, it is a luxury. You are living a luxurious life. And whereas for you it is a musibat, it is a necessity, the most impractical vehicle on the road. Any two-wheeler is meant for only a circus, really. Because any vehicle which will not stop on its own when you stop it, it's not a vehicle. It's a circus thing it is. Really, it's not a vehicle. And therefore this scooter is the worst of it. But anyway, ours is a scooter economy country, developing economy. From bicycle to scooter. You see that? Increasing number. It's a big business too. And so this, we have this what you call two-wheeler economy now, from bullock cart to two-wheeler, automated two-wheeler. Great. Then slowly, some of them, and buy a Maruti. And this Maruti, you go on wiping it every day. Because luxury, you look at it also with great love. my thing, luxury. In fact, it is a dabba. Anybody sneezes, it becomes potlam. And that is Maruti, dangerous car. But then for our roads, Maruti is good enough if you can escape every day. Take it out and bring home without getting snicked anywhere. It can't afford to have a snick. Well, luxury afterwards is nothing. It's a part of your life. People may say it's luxury is nothing. Without it, you can't live. It's a necessity. Air conditioning is a luxury. And once you get used to it, now you go and work in another building where there is no air conditioning. You can't, because you are softened now. Because it's a necessity. People think it's a luxury. No, it's a necessity. It's a clean environment you need. Is a necessity, especially when the environment is hot and it is stuffy and then humid and full of dust. You require a safe environment. And if the environment is available and you get used to it, then it is not a luxury, please. People may think it is luxury. It's not. In time it becomes a necessity. You can't be without. What is a luxury? What you can't be without. No, what you can be without is a luxury. What is a necessity? What you cannot be without it. That is a necessity. So every necessity was a luxury once upon a time, until you had it. Funny. Desires are like that. They were given to us as only a luxury. It's a human luxury. But then, due to our own, I would say, aviveka, lack of attention, not that we are incapable of seeing this, lack of paying attention to ourselves, they have turned into monsters. Just look at this thesis. Suppose these desires I learned to manage, this is our philosophy, I learned to manage these desires without letting them manage me, correct? They will remain as luxuries. I use it when I need it. If they don't manage me, I enjoy having them, I enjoy the process of fulfilling them, and if that kind of freedom I have with reference to these desires, I am on top of them, they are not swaying me. They don't subjugate me. I keep them as my privilege, really. Therefore, Lord Krishna has a real program of life. It's not a philosophy, it's a philosophy of life. It's a program of living, intelligent living, which will help me manage my likes and dislikes. I don't say you should not have likes and dislikes, because Lord Krishna says that's what I am in the human mind. And therefore it's better I have them, you have them. But one thing, but let them not have you. It's nice to see a dog wagging its tail when you come home. Your dog wags his tail, so beautiful. That shows his love, his welcome. So his welcoming attitude for you, towards you. It's wonderful. And he does every day. That's not the case with the human beings inside. But the dog always, as a rule, wags his tail and then shows his happiness, you have come. Others at home run into the rooms because you have come, because you are such a wonderful man. Think of the tail wagging the dog. The tail remains the same. The dog is wagged. Okay. Tail wagging the dog is not a happy situation for the dog. And the dog can't afford to have that kind of a tail. much less you can afford to have desires which wag you. But they do wag you. They do affect you. What is sorrow? What is disappointment otherwise? What is regret? What is dissatisfaction? What is this big sense of failure if the desires don't wag you? They wag you. You have to change. Either you remove the desires or you make them what they are. You can't remove them, number one. No desire occurs in your head asking for your permission. Never. They have their own logic. It may be psychologic. They have their own logic. They occur in your head. That's it. Whether you are going to pursue them or not, that's left to you. Desires themselves are a privilege, as I told you. And therefore, if I am able to enjoy the process of fulfilling them, and the results as they come, I am able to take them objectively, dispassionately, learn from what I have gained, and keep going. That's what living is. And therefore the whole process is enjoyable. You are not putting a happiness in the future, so that if these desires fulfilled, I will be happy. Otherwise, I won't be happy. That only puts pressure on you, like the pressure you put on cricketers. The people don't take it as a game. Poor Pakistanis are paralyzed, really, because they know that they can't go back if they lose. Too much pressure. You don't know where the bat is, even. You stand paralyzed. Balls go this way and that way. Nothing is happening. Overs are over. Paralyzed. Unnecessary pressure. A game is a game. And then only you can relax. When you don't relax, you are tense. That's exactly what they want. And it is the case with all people. But the people do not put pressure, at least. Already they have got enough pressure. The expectations are there, but not this kind of pressure. Burning the houses, this is not correct. Putting pressures on people like that, nobody can play. Similarly, here this is exactly what is happening. One cannot even perform to one's own optimum level. If one is inhibited by this frustration centered on oneself, the fear, the anxiety syndrome, all these are all the outcome of frustration centered on oneself. Lord Krishna gives you a plan of life. This is our philosophy of living. It is not a philosophy to talk about in some university classes where there are four students, and so four students with three glasses. So this is not the philosophy that we are talking about, speculation. What that fellow thought, what this fellow thought. Who cares? This is living. This is philosophy of life, living. So he tells me, just I will give you quickly. What does he say? Tayoho vasham na agachet. Tauhasya paripantinav. Do not come under this ragadvesha. You keep them with you. That's all the meaning. You keep them with you. Let them not take you for a hostage. As a hostage. You don't allow yourself to be subjugated by them. You enjoy the privilege. How? He says, you have limited knowledge. You have limited skills. You have limited power, limited resources, limited time. Understand also, the time frame is very important. Especially in software, time frame is always important. Because everybody else is trying to go ahead.
It's not a race that is going on. Healthy. Competition is there, it's healthy, it's fine. That's a game. It's exactly a game. There are rules, you follow the rules and you sometimes win the race, sometimes you lose the race, but you don't plan to lose the race. That is called match fixing, you know. You plan to win the race. Sometimes you plan to win the race by going slow. Like Australians did with West Indies, I am told. I was reading an article. They wanted to, you know, go slow. They were sure that they were winning. And they were going slow. So that they could avoid somebody else. So this kind of a thing, that is all planned. That is all planned. It's all in the game. But you win the race. You want to win the race. You work for it. There is a time frame. All these are constraints. And with this you work. Naturally, being a game, you may win, you may lose. Are you ready for the loss? That is the question. Are you ready for the loss? Yes, I am ready for the loss. Next time, I am ready for the loss. Next time, I am not ready. I am ready for sannyas, not loss anymore. And therefore, here, what I say, that it is not always a loss. You work for, if it is consistently a loss, then there is something wrong in the whole undertaking. You are knocking at the wrong door. Therefore, there can't be a consistent loss unless the whole venture is wrong. Or the way we go about is wrong. We have to learn from it and keep going for the victory, for the success, being ready for whatever that comes, to learn from it. Understand, the thinking is absolutely positive. But taking into account my limitations, karmanyeva adhikarahame, I have a choice over my action. Over the result of my action, I have no choice. I have literally freedom in my hands to make a sound. The freedom is in my hands. I can cause a sound. I need not. It's in my hands. Correct? Is in my hands. But it is not in my hands anymore. Once I do this, it is not in my hands to avoid the sound. It is not in my hands. Once done, finish. I can't ask the hands, don't make noise. Don't make noise. Don't make noise. Double noise. One is hands making noise, plus my request, don't make noise. This is it. Like in some audience I hear, silence please, silence please. So the silence please, 100 fellows saying silence please. Then I have to tell these fellows, hey, silence please fellows, be silent. Makes noise. Naturally there is something wrong in my expectation. So that I expected, no noise after clapping is the limitation of my knowledge. That is why we say, to err is human. Accept it. To err is human. Then what? To commit the same error is what? Is angelic or what? To err is human. And commit the same error. I don't know what to say. I can't say it is human anymore. Because only to err is human. To repeat the same error cannot be human. It should be angelic. Understand? Or foolish. You can choose whatever you want. If you choose angelic, the second one is proven better. Sometimes it is good to, it's good to say I am foolish. Because when you say I am foolish, when you are really foolish, you are no more foolish. At least you are aware of it, you know. You're not foolish. It takes some wisdom to say I'm foolish. I was foolish. It's better to say that so that the other fellow cannot say any more to you. This is called management of shame. Understand? This is how you manage shame. Before the other fellow points out that was a foolish thing, they have gossiping going on. Therefore you say, hey, I was foolish to do that. Then they can't do anything. You take the wind out of the sails. They can't do anything. Then they will say, no, sir, that's okay. It's all management. I have a lot of insights about management, which we will have some time later. Insights about management, I will talk on that. But then here, that I have a choice over my action, result I have no choice over. I have to take it as it is, because it's given to me. It is given to me to act, because I am free to act. Because I am free to desire, I am free to act. But once I have acted upon, with the data available for me, to the best of my ability, and planning very well, and Lord Krishna adds one more somewhere, Devam Chaivatra Panchamam. He says, take into account the hidden variables. You cannot control the hidden variables. Why? Because they are hidden. Even the known variable not able to control. Hidden variables, how? Like the bugs in your software. How to control? A practical vision of living. We have a prayer. Before I came here, I went to the prayer room and came here. Perfect. Control the hidden variables. Pray. If you don't pray, it's okay. But you remain helpless. When you pray, you do something for the helplessness. Correct? When you do something for the helpless situation, you are no more helpless. Is it not true? Because you are acting upon it. Really speaking, every human being can be very effective if one doesn't feel helpless all the time. What is paralyzing, emotionally paralyzing, and sponging away your psychic energy, and therefore your energy in coping up with difficult situations, is this helplessness, constant feeling of helplessness. You can't change your mother, she cannot change your mother-in-law. Helplessness. You can't change your mother, husband cannot change his mother, and she cannot get along with her, because she cannot change her, nor mother-in-law can change her, and nor you are supporting her. Daily it is a waterloo. Perhaps both of you together can face the situation. That is the correct thing to do. Alone one cannot handle. Both perhaps can handle, because the best way of handling, you know what? Conclude, we cannot change. Then learn how to understand the person and help the person change. Perhaps help the person be what the person is. Just live a simple life. We can live a nice life. Well, it all takes to avoid helplessness, for which one has to take into account Devam. Lord Krishna says in the Gita, the Devam. Devam Chaivatra Panchamam. When he talks about action, he talks about the various things that are necessary for an action. And the fifth one he says, Devam. And because success is only relative, it is a given undertaking. To be successful, there is always this factor. I call it a third factor, the Devam. Prayatnam, Kalam, Devam. Effort, time, and the third factor, Devam. And that is meant for hidden variable. If this is so, I have a choice over action. The result is taken care of. When the result comes, it can be equal, more, less or opposite. There is no fifth result. With reference to your expectation, equal,
fine. You expected this, you got it, fine. More than what you expected, wonderful. Very rare, wonderful. Thankful. Less, it can be worse, okay? Therefore, acceptable. And opposite sometimes. This is what I say by an example. You want to cross the road and catch the bus. This is a typical situation. Cross the road and catch the bus. You cross the road and caught the bus. Equal. You cross the road and miss the bus. Less than what you wanted. You cross the road, got a ride to your home. Free ride. A friend of yours stops his car and gives you a ride. He drops you at your doorsteps. Doesn't happen every day. But it does happen in life. More than what you expected. There is one more result. You were crossing the road. 2 days later you wake up in the hospital and ask these fundamental questions. Who am I? Where am I? What for I am here? Puriyarda? Every action is fraught with four. Therefore, Krishna says that these fourfold results come to you. We want to get the number one equal to our expectation. More than expectation, of course, you are lucky. Less than expectation, you have to expect that too. But you are not working for it. But you should expect it. This is what I say. And sometimes opposite too. So these four types of result, from the standpoint of your expectation, are there in every action, even in simple eating. It is there, you can think it over. In every job that you do, in every software you write, all these four are possible. Or in the marketing, or in marketing. All these four are involved. Therefore, what I say, you work for success or right. But when the result comes, be ready to take it. Learn from it. Go ahead. Learn from it. Go ahead. In the process, what happens? That ragadveshas become a privilege because they don't bother you anymore. Because you enjoy the process of working. You enjoy the very process. Nobody works for money, really speaking. You should enjoy the process. If you work for money, you can never be satisfied, I tell you. Because you can always have some more money. Who doesn't want to have some more money? You know, everybody can have some more money. If you have a little more money, you can have a better flat, better apartment. And if you have a little more money, you can have a better car. A little more money, you need not work, you know. This is all, everybody wants a little more money. This is endless it is. And therefore, when are you going to be happy? And so, we all need money. That's fun. Have more money. That's good. But enjoy the process of working. This is our management. You don't even manage at all. Everybody loves his job. This is what they call duty. What is this duty? The concept of duty is nothing but enjoying what is to be done. What is to be done is duty. And every situation calls for an action from you. That is what is to be done. I don't like it. Please do it. I like it. Then I need not say do it. So what is to be done, you better like it. If you don't like it, do it. And you will begin liking it. If the attitude is proper, you will begin liking it. And that's just loving, enjoying the very process. It makes me very dynamic. The best management is which needs the least management. And for which each one is managing himself very well. Whether it's a simple job or a big job. There is a hierarchy inevitable. There are different jobs. There may be disparity in salaries, etc. It's all inevitable, I suppose. But then, nobody is less important than the other. In a machine, the piston is as important as even the bolts that hold the piston. The boasting piston goes on teasing the bolts. "You nuts, you are sitting tight." The nuts went on responding to this without any response, you know. That was the response, nuts' response. "You are sitting tight, you are not doing anything. I am working, look at this, you are sitting tight, you are sitting tight." Then, being teased so many times, the nuts thought, "I think we should also work." So, they tried to move this way, they couldn't move. And therefore, they tried to move the other way, they moved. After some time, they moved. They went on moving. "Ah, we are also working, we are also working." You know what happened? Jobs differ. Somebody has to sit tight. Understand? Somebody has to move. One is not inferior to the other. Either in the body politic or in the scheme of things in any given setup. Every individual is as important as every other individual. Duties differ. And the best management is coming from oneself. Never from outside. "I don't allow anybody to manage me, because I manage myself so well, I don't need anybody to manage me." Who is the other person to manage me? When he himself doesn't know how to manage himself. Nobody has to manage anybody. If everybody manages himself. Otherwise, whatever happened, then manager, then assistant manager, then general manager, then administrative manager, the manager to be managed, to be managed, to be managed, to be managed, to be managed. This is endless. So our ethos is very good. We go by duties. Even today, we have it in our blood. The man asks, says, "Hey, are you ready? Let's go. Here." "No, I have got duty today." What he means is, yes, to go to work. You will not hear in America, "I have got duty today." He says, "I have work today. I have joined duty." They never say, "I have joined duty, I have taken up a job." "I begin working from today. I am resigning from duties." "I am resigning my job. I have fulfilled all my duties." I never hear them at all there. I hear every day, I get letters. People writing to me, "Swamiji, I am ready to come to your ashram. I have fulfilled all my duties." As though I asked him to fulfill all the duties and come to me. Dina or Bhatta letter, it's my Vaidigar. So this concept, I have duties to perform. I have not yet fulfilled my duties. In America, I hear the word duty only in one or two places. Heavy duty vehicle, light duty vehicle. Nowhere. Never I heard this word duty in any other situation. We have it in our blood. Bring it out. Let everybody manage himself very well so that he doesn't need to be managed. You not only retain your self-dignity and you make the whole unit also prosper. And it's wonderful. Like a body, they cannot fight, the liver cannot fight with kidneys. They can't fight. The liver has to do its job, kidneys have to do its job. Kidney says, "Why, you alone should do the liver job. I want to do the liver job. You do the kidney job. Let us change. Thoda exchange karayin." He said, this kind of problems should not exist there. That's why they all work like this. You know. They do the jobs as long as they can do. That's how things work. And so that one thing I want to tell finally, if I am able to manage my desires in this manner, taking the results of action objectively, I can bring in an element of here a religious attitude, the attitude of prasada, if I can bring in. Because anything that is given is what is called, is given by the laws. The laws are not created by me, the laws of the Lord. And any result that I get being given to me is from the laws of the Lord. Therefore, anything that comes from the Lord, we have in our culture already, is what? You tell me, is what? Is what? Prasad. If a laddu is given to this person, he is frightened of it. Why? Because he has got sugar. And he loves laddu. He loves laddu, he has got sugar, therefore he can't look at it. When he looks at it, he feels like eating, he should not eat, therefore he protests. No. The more no he says, the more he wants. Understand that? No. And he says, this is from Tirupati, Venkateshwara. Oh. Really? He may not eat the whole thing because still it is calories. But it is no more laddu. It is prasada. Understand that? It is because of a new piece of knowledge. Previously it was pure calories. And now it is prasada. Because he knows it is from the Lord. This is our culture, our philosophy, our religion. Every result of action is from the Lord. In the sense, it is not given to me to shape it all the way. If I can shape it, I can call all the shots. I will never have failure. If I shape the result all the time, I don't. Then I take the result as it comes as prasada. And go ahead. And all the desires do not bother me anymore. They become again a privilege. Over a period of time they become a privilege. It is a program of living. A particular attitude changes the whole course of my life, my efficiency, my performance, my role playing as husband, wife, as mother, father. As son, daughter, I can play all the roles very well. If only I have this healthy attitude of managing myself. If I manage myself, I don't need to be managed by anybody. I have to be only told what is to be done. Period. Nothing else. Why should anybody manage me? I have to be told and I know what is to be done. I'm told already. That is another problem. That's called problem of communication. So that's entirely different thing. That is a management problem. That management has to communicate what exactly it expects of you. And once you are informed, well, you do it. You don't need to be managed by anybody. And if you are managed too much also, you can't do. Like Pakistanis. Pressure on your head. You can't do that. Especially if it is software. It's impossible. And so you have to manage yourself. And you manage yourself. There's a time frame, you know it. And you manage yourself. Each one begins to enjoy the very job that he or she does. That day, that becomes over, as the attitude changes, you'll find every day you begin enjoying. The more you enjoy, the more successful you are in your life. Correct? What is success now? It is not fulfillment of desires is success. If that is so, we are all failures. If it is management of desires, this sheer management, the more you manage your desires well, the more you are successful in life. Correct? There is no failure at all. This is our concept of success. Nobody can compete with it. I can talk this in Harvard, I can talk in Washington, I can talk anywhere, and everybody has to say yes. Even in Frankfurt, in a place where there is cutthroat competition, all these German CEOs I've talked to, this concept of success. They all
they have nothing to say against it. They all say, yes, we wish we have this attitude. In fact, you will be more successful. You will be able to fulfill more desires really with that attitude. Because you are ready for the failure. There is no failure. Because you enjoy the process. Where is failure? Where do you draw a line? You enjoy the process. And Lord Krishna finally says, when you begin enjoying the process, you don't cut corners. You know? You don't cut corners. In order to fulfill a desire, you don't cut corners. You know cutting corners? Adharma. Going against dharma. Going against the rules of the game. Fouling. Ball tampering. And picking up the ball from the ground and saying that I caught the ball. They do this all the time. There is no game. Because of pressure. If you begin enjoying the process, you follow dharma. The rules of the game. Therefore the Lord says, I am desire in you when it is in keeping with dharma. Dharma aviruddha kamosmi bharatarsham. Correct? It's not mere desire. Dharma aviruddha kamosmi. I am there very much in you in the form of a desire when it conforms to the rules of the game. While one is in the process of fulfilling it. What a beauty. That's wonderful. That's a philosophy. It is a wisdom. I won't call it philosophy, it is wisdom. Dharma aviruddha kamosmi bharatarsham. Because there is no pressure. I enjoy the process. Desires remain privilege and as manifestation of Ishvara. So it's not a one day life. It's a whole life itself. It's a process. And in the process, I hone myself properly. Like even you make your software more effective, more efficient, and more what you call that quick and problem solving, etc. How you go on amending, editing, changing, etc., perfecting. Whole life itself becomes a process of honing yourself, and you enjoy. Thank you. I enjoy talking to you.
Maka Ganapat Manasa Smarami Maka Deva Mudam Shirasa Namami Maka Ganapat Manasa Smarami.